Hey guys, how's it going? Today I want to talk about spider mites. It's something we're dealing with in our garden right now, and it's actually the number one pest nemesis in our area and one of the hardest things to control. So I wanted to talk about what spider mites are, how to prevent them, what to use to control them with. I'll show you all the stuff that I'm using and so forth. So let's just start with what spider mites are. They are just tiny little spiders. They measure, an adult measures 1/50th of an inch long. Like, they are hard to see with your naked eye, and they like to reside on the undersides of leaves, so you even have to like pick up the leaf to see a spider mite even on your plant. They do like to live in colonies, so eventually once their population starts to boom and expand, you will start to notice more of a presence, because in the beginning you will notice just a slight stippling on the top of the leaf, because what the spider mites do is they poke a hole in the bottom side of the leaf and then suck the juice of the leaf out. All the fluids in the leaf come out of that spot, and so it leaves like a little yellow dot. But they do that all over the entire leaf to where it looks very stippled or dusty. And then once the population has expanded, you may even start to see a fine webbing. I've seen like hydrangea blooms, for example, completely covered in fine webbing from spider mites, or like a whole branch or whole section of leaves covered. That's when it becomes a really hard problem to deal with. So it's something you really want to keep your eye on, especially if it's something you know you deal with, so that you can get on top of them before they become a big problem. So a spider mite population can go from being very small and seemingly insignificant to a huge problem in a very short amount of time. Because one female spider mite, after they've mated, they can continuously lay hundreds of eggs over the course of a couple weeks, like up to 300 eggs in just 2 weeks. And if those spider mite eggs are given ideal conditions, which are hot and dry conditions, which is what we have here in the high desert, they can go from an egg stage to an adult stage in as little as 5 days. So you're dealing with tons of generations of these spider mites just overlapping one another and just creating this huge issue really fast if you're not watching for it. So like I said, they like a very hot, dry climate. They also like places where it's breezy or windy, which we usually get a very good windstorm, not good, a very strong windstorm once a week here, and they like to surf the wind. So they'll just, like, the wind will pick them up, they'll fly through the air and then land on something else and start infecting that. So it's just something that can, I mean, it can just become like a garden-wide problem pretty quick. We're going to be showing you our boxwoods today. We have a hedge of boxwoods on the west side of our house that have been fine for a couple of years, but this year they got nailed by spider mites. I thought it was just dust because of all of our wind and all the dustiness. We have a lot of building going on around us, and it is a combination of dust, but also a combination of spider mites as well. And if you find the spider mites early enough, you can eradicate them, control them, the plant will rebound. But if you leave it unchecked, it's possible the spider mites could eventually take that plant. So that's just a little bit of information about spider mites in terms of what they are and how to look for damage. Now I want to talk about controlling them. There's so many different things out there, so I kind of want to break this up into sections, kind of. Starting with the most benign things you can do, which really doesn't happen at an infestation level. It happens more as a preventative and creating an environment that spider mites don't like, and then working our way up to the more toxic chemicals that are available, which I'm not necessarily advocating for, but I do really feel like we should talk about those things, because if you're not sure or you don't know and you just run to the store and grab something that's labeled for spider mites and you happen to grab something that's fairly toxic, it may have more ripple effects than you're aware of, and you might end up with a bigger problem. So I think it's a good thing to just talk about all of it. So the first thing we can do is try to create an environment that discourages spider mites. So something that's opposite of being dry and hot. So the first way you can do this is if your plants are undergoing any kind of drought stress, make sure to keep them well watered. If that means running a drip line by them so that they will consistently receive moisture, if you're really busy and just don't have the time, it will be well worth it. If that means going out with your hose more often, do it, because a sick plant will be much more likely to attract bugs than a healthy plant will. And when you're out there with your hose the plant down. It doesn't have to be a full watering. Like, our plants, our boxwoods that have spider mites, are already well watered. So I know it's not a drought stress problem, but it's the dry and hot around the leaves that's kind of encouraging the mites there. So if we go out with our hose and spray down the leaves just to kind of create that moisture around the plant, and we do it consistently, spider mites are less likely to want to take up residence there. And when we spray our plants down, it also knocks dust off the leaves, which dust encourages mites. So just keeping your plant clean and well watered will be very, very helpful. And then the last thing for kind of environment is keeping the area around the plant, like on the ground where the plant drops leaves and junk, keep that all cleaned up all the time because a lot of eggs can harbor over in that debris. The second thing you can do is you can release beneficial insects like ladybugs, and there is a type of predatory mite, same family as the spider mite, but they eat on the bad spider mites. I don't know a ton about that one because I've never have released those in my own garden, but there are kind of three different windows of a spider mite issue. There is like before a spider mite issue ever happens. Like if you know you deal with spider mites every year, but you haven't seen any presence of any spider mites, if you release beneficials at that point and there's no food source for them, they will take off. They won't stay in your garden and wait for an infestation or for any kind of food to show up. And then the second window is kind of like a middle ground, like right when you start to see a little bit of spider mite activity, that's the perfect time to release beneficials because there is a food source there, but it hasn't gotten to a point of like the third window, which is a major infestation. When you have your plants covered in spider mites and there's webbing all over, beneficials usually can't keep up with that sort of problem. And the third, and I think most common way to get rid of spider mites is just to spray them. There's a lot of different things you can use, which we will run through, but a couple pieces of information, which I wish I would have known early on, is that one, it's rarely once and done. I mean, rarely can you go down to the store, pick up something labeled for spider mites, spray them once, and expect to not see the problem again. Because you're dealing with so many different generations of spider mites hatching all the time, you might spray something that kills the adults by contact, but then you still have all those eggs laying there that haven't hatched yet, so it didn't affect all of those. So it might seem like you beat the population down for a very short time, and then all of a sudden you have another boom. So oftentimes it takes spraying them once a week for several weeks in a row to get them under control. The second thing is that they tend to build up a resistance to pesticides. So if you're using that exact same spray every single week, it's likely that they're going to build up a resistance and eventually it will become a lot less effective. And you will start noticing them kind of like their population will rebound and it will start growing again. So it's a good idea to choose two or three different kinds of sprays that have different active ingredients that target the bug differently and rotate through those so that you're making sure to attack the entire generation from egg to adult when you're spraying. So now I want to run through 9 different sprays that are available that are labeled for spider mites, starting with the most benign organic way you can do it, moving toward the synthetics, things that have more of a systemic quality that stick around on the plant a little bit longer. The ones you see on the table here are the ones I'm going to be using on our actual boxwood, so I'll go through all of that in the end. But I do want you to keep in mind that whether or not you're spraying an organic or a synthetic in this case, they're all more of a broad spectrum insecticide. They are not just labeled for spider mites. So you want to be very careful about when you're spraying any kind of pesticide. The best time to do that is at dusk, after the honeybees and the beneficials have gone away for the night. They're not feeding on flowers. You just want to make sure that you are killing as few of those as possible. So dusk is the best time. So the first one on the list, the most benign, is insecticidal soap. You've probably heard of that before. That is one that does not have a very long residual, if at all. I think it pretty much just kills on contact. And so it's something that in my case with my infestation, it's a little bit too benign. It won't beat down the population quick enough. And in some cases, you need to kind of get on top of what's going on out there before it creates even bigger of a problem. But I think it's a really good option if you're just starting to notice some activity. You've got houseplants that have it that are more quarantined a little bit, like they're more in the house. They're not outside affecting anything else. I think that's a really good option. The next one is called MiteX, which I have showed to you in a video before. It worked great for me on houseplants. The actives in that are, let me see if I can remember, clove oil, garlic oil, and cottonseed oil. I don't think that one's labeled like for organic gardening, but it is a natural, and it actually has a pleasant smell, and it really took care of the problem. Again, I can't get that one in a concentrate, so it's not something I can use on a larger scale project outside, but I think if you've got like a single plant that's affected or houseplants that have it, it's a great one to use. The third one is neem oil, which I have this jug right here. This is a ready to use, which means it's already diluted in water. It's already ready to go. It's got a little spray wand that you can attach up here and spray. Now my problem's too big to use a ready to use. I need to run down to the garden center still and get a concentrate so that I can have it spread further. But if you've got a small problem, ready to uses of any of these things are so wonderful because they're just usually less expensive, and they're like less work on your part. So you could use the neem oil. You could use another one's called Rose RX. The active in that is also neem oil. But I like to use this one in between my other two sprays that I'm using because it targets the eggs better. It helps smother the eggs. So not only are you helping kill the adults, but then you're targeting another part of the life cycle, which I think is super important. Number four is a spinosad-based spray. This is called Captain Jack's Dead Bug. This is actually what we use for spraying on budworms. This and the BT or Thuricide might be the label on that. It helps combat those type of caterpillars, like even on cabbage and broccoli. If you have leaf miners in your beets like I did, this works really well, and it is for organic gardening. This is actually what we're going to be using as our first round of spray for the spider mites. So this is going to be a really benign way to help kind of beat down the population. Then we follow it up with the neem oil, and then I'll talk about the third one here in just a second. Again, I wouldn't spray, well, any of these things in the middle of the day on flowers where, you know, pollinators are going along, because these are contact killers as well. So all of these things, like, I just kind of want to keep repeating every fourth chemical I talk about. We'll just say, do it at dusk when the pollinators have gone to bed for the night. Thankfully, we're just spraying boxwoods, so we have no flowers to contend with, which makes it a little bit easier. Number five is one called All Seasons Horticultural Oil, which is another one that will help smother eggs. It's actually one that I use as a dormant oil application on our fruit trees. I typically don't use it for spider mites, but it is an option, and it is for organic gardening as well. And the last kind of in my natural or organic lineup is one called Citrus Fruit and Nut Orchard Spray. Now the actives in that one are sulfur and pyrethrins, which it is labeled for spider mites, but you do need to be very careful with that one, anything with sulfur in it. If you're coupling that with any of the other oils, so horticultural oil, neem oil, they have to be sprayed 30 days apart from one another, because if they're sprayed closer, it can become toxic to the plant. So it's maybe one, like, if you have it on hand and you're not using it coupled with any other oil, then go for it. You can use that. But just wanted to throw that out there, that you don't want to use those in conjunction with each other necessarily. But it is labeled for mites. So for the last three on my list, we're moving into the synthetic side of things. Number seven is malathion, which is actually one I'm going to be using on our boxwoods. The thing I like about this, it's pretty low still on the toxicity scale. When I have a problem like I'm dealing with right now, I feel like adding something in that's got a tiny bit of a residual is really helpful. Because if you've got a massive infestation, 100% organics, they just don't last long enough, that they don't really help get the population under control fast enough. If I had caught it a little earlier, I would have probably tried to do it 100% organically. But the thing I like about malathion is you spray it. It is a contact killer, much like, I mean, other organics that are out there, but it will absorb into the leaf tissue of the plant. It does not translocate into the pollen or the blooms though. So even though it will stay in your plant for about a week after you spray it, it's not going to affect anything feeding on the blooms, which is so important to me. But it will still kill, not anything that's crawling on the plant or crawling on the leaf, only things that eat the leaf. So I feel like on the synthetic side, the systemic side, this one is fairly benign. And this is going to be our third week spray. So we'll be doing our Captain Jack's, our neem, our malathion, and then we're gonna do that whole regimen again. So we'll be doing six sprays, 6 weeks. Number eight on the list is eight. I didn't even plan it that way. The active ingredient is called permethrin, and I'm honestly not super familiar about this one because I don't use it in my garden. I know a lot of people do. It's something that has been sold down at my parents' garden center forever, and it's still labeled for vegetables and use all over the place, but it does have a longer residual. And when you're using it on edibles, it says, I think it's up to like 3 or 4 days. You have to wait from spraying to harvesting. I typically don't like to spray any of my edible stuff with anything I would have to wait on. So anyway, I feel like, I mean, it's out there, it's labeled for spider mites. If you're spraying something like boxwoods, it probably wouldn't matter so much. It's probably not something I would spray on edibles. But then again, I need to do some research on that one. And the last one on my list is called systemic insect control. The active ingredient is called acephate. This one, even though it's not the highest on the toxicity level, it is the most toxic one I wanted to bring up today because it is labeled for spider mites. And I do feel like because it's available, we need to talk about it. I think that's really important. I think there are very few cases where it is appropriate. Like spraying boxwoods, it would be okay. Spraying any kind of evergreen, just non-blooming things. Because what this systemic does is it enters the plant's system and it does translocate to flowers and pollen. So if, you know, you were just a person that didn't really know about what to buy or whatever, went to the store, somebody recommended that one, you picked it up, went home, and let's say you sprayed roses that had spider mites. Roses are susceptible to spider mites, for us anyway. So you spray down your roses, not knowing that you're not only, if you're not spraying at the right time of the day, you could be killing bugs, beneficials that are out feeding while you're spraying, but it's also entering the plant system and possibly killing those beneficials for up to 2 weeks after they fed on the flowers of that plant. So like I say, like boxwoods with no blooms on them, let's say like you have a huge hedge of arborvitaes. I'm looking at ours right now. Thank God ours don't have spider mites right now, but that would be a much more appropriate situation to use something like that, because it, you don't have to worry about any of those beneficials, you know, eating on any part of the plant or feeding on part of that plant. So that's pretty much it in terms of sprays that I wanted to run through, because I think they're the ones that are most commonly found and found widespread, like found not only at your local garden center, but also found at box stores as well. The only thing left here on my table that I wanted to show you was the spreader sticker. So oftentimes I only use this when we're, you know, spraying weeds, and it helps the chemical that we're spraying the weeds with adhere to the leaves of the weed and not just beat up and roll off. If you're spraying things that have like a waxy cuticle like boxwoods or something that's really shiny and slick, oftentimes you spray something and it just runs off the plant. If you add in a little bit of the spreader sticker in with your spray, it will help things stick and it'll be much more effective. So the last two things I wanted to cover in this video are how to spray, and then also real quick, I want to just touch on proper PPE and how you should be spraying it, which I'm not spraying anything no matter how organic it is this year because I am pregnant. Erin has been handling all of that for me this year. So first off, there are three different ways you can spray something. First is the ready to use. So if you get a bottle that's already pre-mixed, it has a spray bottle option. Hi, Russell. That honestly, if you've got a small infestation, that's the way to go. It's least expensive. It's less work on your part. It's already properly mixed. You don't even need to add any spreader sticker in. You don't have to worry about that. It's just ready to roll. The other two ways are using a concentrate. And the first way is probably the most common. You're going to be using a pump sprayer of some kind, which you can get in varying different sizes, all the way from like half gallon to like a 4 gallon backpack sprayer. So what you'll do is you'll take your, let's say Captain Jack's. I can't remember what you, let me see how much you mix. I think it's 2 ounces. It is 2 ounces per gallon for the Captain Jack's. First, before we measure it, we need to shake the bottle. Whether or not you're using organic or synthetic, especially on organics, you want to make sure to shake the bottles really well to make sure all the everything is dispersed properly inside. And since we use a 2 gallon pump sprayer, we're going to need to measure out 4 ounces of the Captain Jack's to make our 2 gallons. So we'll pour the Captain Jack's into this little clear cup that has indicator lines on it. It makes it super easy to measure. Can't really mess it up. And then we take that and pour it into our pump sprayer, which we then take to our hose and fill it up, and then we're ready to roll. And the last way is to use a hose end sprayer, which makes it very fast and efficient if you've got a big area you need to spray, which is kind of where we're at. It would take us a lot of different pump sprayers full to get this project done. So a hose end sprayer works really well. Now my hose end sprayer is really old, so it's gonna look different probably than the ones you can find on the market right now. They all work essentially the same way. And what you do is you have this little empty hopper that you unscrew from the top kind of mechanism of the hose end sprayer, and then you fill it with your concentrate. You don't add any water into that hopper, just the concentrate. And then you replace that, you screw it back onto the top of the sprayer, and then you attach it to your hose. And then you'll want to look at the top. Now each one of them will look a little bit different, but you want to set the mix ratio to the proper amount. So like for Captain Jack's, we need to set it for 2 ounces. And what it will do is as the water is cruising through the top of that sprayer, it will draw up exactly the amount of spray concentrate it needs to dilute it properly. And it will shoot that diluted spray out the end of the hose. So it just makes it so efficient. And whatever is left in the hopper at the very end is still your concentrate. You can pour it back down into your bottle and you're good to go for next time. And then very last, for those of you who may have questions about proper PPE, is something that we usually skip in videos, which I think we should like be a little bit more diligent about talking about, even if it's just real quick. Of course, you'll want to do long sleeves, long pants, and closed-toed shoes, but you also need proper gloves, which you can use something like this. These are disposable nitrile gloves, which I prefer because then you can take them off and toss them, and then you don't have to worry about cleaning them properly and such. Then you've got this option here. These are just a stronger, thicker, like a chemical resistant rubber glove right here, but then you have to clean and dry and you know. And then last is the proper type of mask. And I know there's a lot of different talk about masks going on. And so, like, initially you think, oh, an N95 mask, like, that's the best kind of mask. Maybe I should grab that one. That is actually not proper for something like this. It doesn't help with chemical application. You need an actual respirator with the proper filters. So the proper filters are like a Vapor P100 filter. So those are the things that you need to look for if you want to go about it like 100% proper and protect yourself. So that's pretty much it, you guys. I hope this video didn't get too long or too confusing. It's just a fairly big subject, and I really wanted to cover like all those different sprays, because it's something that's confusing when you're standing in front of like a wall full of sprays and you're like, I don't know what to get. What should I go, you know, get that works together? And then knowing that you need to have more than one type of spray and that you need to spray more often. Like, those are things that I missed out on for several years before I knew how to properly take care of them. And it has helped me out so big time. So anyway, hope this video was helpful. Hope you're having a great day, and we will see you in the next one. Bye.